Welcome to Lingthusiasm, a podcast that's enthusiastic about linguistics. I'm Gretchen McCulloch.
And I'm Lauren Gawne. And today we're getting enthusiastic about whether you're getting enthusiastic about theory of mind. But first, our most recent bonus episode is on translation in fiction, mostly translating between human languages and non-human languages, but all kinds of translation.
You can get access to this translation episode about some books we've been reading recently and 50 other bonus episodes by becoming a patron at patreon.com/lingthusiasm. And here's a bit of a preview into the books we talk about.
We talked about Semiosis by Sue Burke and A Memory Called Empire by Arkady Martin, as well as The Devil Comes Courting by Courtney Milan. And Gretchen, you have read Native Tongue by Suzette Hayden Elgin.
I finally got around to reading Native Tongue, which has been much recommended to me.
A classic piece of linguistic sci-fi.
Yes. And you don't have to have read any of these books beforehand. We don't provide plot spoilers, although we'll talk about some of the things of the setting. So it's fun whether you've read any of them or not at all. You might end up with some new things to read.
You can get access to that episode and all of our bonus episodes at patreon.com/lingthusiasm. Gretchen, I'm going to run an experiment on you.
Okay, I like experiments.
Excellent. This one involves a lot of a setup, but it's great because you can do it. And if you are listening along, you can also do the experiment along with us.
Great. What's our setup?
We have Sally and Anne.
Okay.
Sally has a basket and Anne has a box.
Okay.
Sally has a marble. Sally with the basket, and she puts her marble into the basket.
Mm-hmm.
And then she goes out for a walk. So Sally's not here, but we've got a basket with a marble in it.
Sally's not here. We've got her basket with the marble in it. Okay.
And we've got a box, and Anne is still there. Anne takes the marble out of the basket and puts it in the box.
So now we've got a marble in a box.
We've got the marble in the box. Sally comes back.
Mm-hmm.
And Sally wants to play with the marble. Where is Sally going to go to get her marble?
So, I'm going to deduce, based on the fact that when Sally left the room, she left the marble in the basket. She probably still thinks the marble's in the basket, because she'd have no reason to assume that things would have changed. And so she's going to try the basket first, because she doesn't know that Anne has moved it.
That is a perfectly reasonable deduction to make. You are a veritable Sherlock Holmes.
Thank you. Did I pass the test?
You did. You completed what is known as the theory of mind test because you kept track of what you knew about the situation and what Sally knew about the situation and all the sneakiness that Anne had perpetrated with the marble.
But presumably at some period earlier in my life, when I was a very young child, I might not have passed this test.
Yeah, the ability to correctly articulate what you know about Sally's likely chances of going to the basket or the box really doesn't settle into being reliable until kind of 3 or 4 years old.
Hmm, okay.
Actually being able to articulate what you know about the state of other people's thinking.
Which feels kind of late because, you know, 2-year-olds, 3-year-olds already have quite a bit of language in most cases. And yet this later reasoning about mental states and, you know, what different people know about different things kind of comes along later.
That's what the theory of mind test seems to indicate. It is a bit more complex than this. This is something that was run for the first time kind of 30 or 40 years ago. There's been more work that's tried to do versions that don't involve language. They just involve looking, and they show that, you know, toddlers, you know, 15 months old are actually maybe better at paying attention to the fact that the marble is in one place or another and what Sally might know a little bit better than they can articulate, though. It's something about being able to put it into words that seems to be one of the challenges that takes until, as you say, like well into language acquisition to be able to do this task consistently.
Neat. And this task feels like something that like some experimenters set up in a lab, and maybe they had puppets or maybe they had two different experimenters. And like these props feel very psychology experiment prop style to me.
What do we have in the props department? Yeah.
And it's funny reading, I was reading a different paper about these types of experiments, and there are other ways you can test for theory of mind. One of my either favorite or least favorite, depending on this, is, shall I do it on you?
Okay, yes.
So I have a box. It's a cardboard box, small cardboard box, and the outside says Kinder chocolate bars, chocolate things.
Yep. Great. I'm very compelled by this box.
So we have our friend Gavagai, who is also in the room and sees this box with the chocolates on it. And Gavagai is called out suddenly to leave to go do something else.
Bye, Gav.
And I open this box and I show you that inside is not, in fact, chocolates, but it is pencils, colored pencils.
This is okay. I was going to say it is a bit of disappointment, but it's something of a disappointment to me.
And they're colored pencils, which is something more exciting than, you know, graphite pencils, but still, they're not chocolates. And then I close the box up again, and it looks like it's closed.
Mm-hmm.
And then our friend Gav comes back in the room.
Hi, Gav.
What does Gav think is in the box?
Well, I know that it's pencils, but Gav wasn't here when I saw that it was pencils. And so Gav still thinks that it's chocolates. And boy, are they in for a disappointment.
Yes, they are. So you can do this about location of item, which is the Sally Ann test, which is about location, or you can do it about identity of item. What's in it?
I have a colleague who's done the theory of mind task with little stones instead of a marble. But then there's like a whole other twist where the stones end up being those little nuggets of chocolate that look like stones.
Oh.
And I just feel like I would be confused by that point about who knows what about the state or location of this rock chocolate situation.
I remember I loved those stones as a child because it felt like you were going to like break a tooth on them and then you would like eat them.
Mm. And you could definitely do some fun false belief with someone about me eating dirt.
There's also a fun one in this study where they found, and I don't know where they got this object because I have not seen an object like this. They have this little toy that looks like a race car, like one of those cars that you know, vroom vroom on the table.
Mm-hmm.
But it turns out when you press a button on it, it turns into a pen, like a pen thing pops out.
Cool.
And so they're trying to see, you know, does this person think it's a race car? Do they think it's a pen? But yeah, like somebody's really going around to toy shops being like, hey, what here could be deceptive?
And keeping track of people's knowledge states, as we said, is something that takes a little bit of effort. Not all animals can necessarily do it. In fact, when we find animals that are really good at this, people get really excited. So there are animals that are closely related to humans, like chimps seem pretty good at this. You can basically do a version of the like location of an object thing and the chimps are all over it.
Mm-hmm.
And also ravens are really good at
ravens
kind of conceptualizing where someone might be and what they might be doing. And so it's kind of one of those skills that isn't just like, well, first of all, you get theory of mind and a bunch of other things, and then you get language. It's not just like an ingredient in the language cake. It's just one of many skills that humans and animals closely related to humans seem to have, but also is scattered throughout the animal kingdom.
I mean, corvids are pretty smart, I guess. Like, they can recognize people. So maybe they can also, you know, if you feed them, they'll become your friends.
And we've run a fairly classic theory of mind experiment at the top of this episode. But as we suggested, people have been pulling apart exactly what theory of mind is and how different people do different elements of it. It seems to be kind of this complicated cluster of features around attention tracking, false belief, mental states. And being able to do all of this is part of being able to do the social element of language.
Right, because a lot of when you're talking about language, you're describing what other people have done. You're thinking like, okay, you know, why did this person behave this weird way this time? Or why did this person do this thing to me? You know, why can't I get this? You're trying to figure out, well, it's because this other person wants this thing, even though that's not what I want. Or it's because this other person knows this thing, even though it's not what I know.
Even just the process of asking a question, like using language to interact with someone to try and get to an end goal, and whether or not they are likely to have the right information that I need to get this question answered. Theory of mind is the kind of having really good foundations on the house of language, and it's part of why I'm always very zen when people talk about computers taking over the ability to do language. It's like, well, first of all, a computer has to be able to keep track of their best guess of the knowledge state of everyone else in the interaction. And that's not necessarily the same kind of programming task as figuring out sounds or morphemes or syntactic structures.
And it's interesting because it is sort of a theory. in the sense that not like the theory of gravity where, you know, scientists have hypothesized that minds might exist, but in the sense that whenever we're interacting with the world, we're hypothesizing that the people around us have intention behind what they're doing, and they're doing stuff for reasons. Like, I have to hypothesize that you, Lauren, have a mind, because I don't actually have direct evidence that you have a mind. I just have, like, maybe you have actually been Lauren bot this entire time.
True. And I am operating under the same premise. So I have my own theory. It's not a shared theory necessarily. We all have this internal idea that the people we're interacting with in conversation are also doing the same mental calculation that we are.
I remember having this realization that, like, people have other mental states and maybe they conceive of the world dramatically differently from how I do. You know, maybe this thing that I see that I call red isn't actually what someone else is seeing, even though they also call it red. I remember having this sort of philosophical realization when I was about 12 or so, thinking, you know, how do we know anything that we're seeing things?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and yet, even though I don't have empirical evidence that you aren't just an extremely sophisticated automaton, I mean, I do have a lot of empirical evidence, actually, because automatons aren't that good yet. But, you know, we still manage to interact with people. We still manage to, you know, operate under a working theory that people do have minds and they are interactable with.
And people have drawn a link between this kind of cognitive foundation and the need for language by looking at the way early human ancestors learnt to socialize with each other. And instead of having small packs of humans, you ended up getting these larger and larger groups. And once you have these larger groups, you have to have some way of maintaining social cohesion that's not just small group dominance. And Robin Dunbar is probably one of the most famous proponents of this idea that language is a way of maintaining social cohesion and that you can keep a happy social relationship with more people, essentially through gossip. Gossip being one of the mechanisms that helped generate the need for language.
I mean, it's useful to know, like, can you trust this person because they were trustworthy last time, or have they been going around and doing things that are not trustworthy, or is this someone that someone else is willing to vouch for? Like, there's lots of sort of reasons why language can help with cooperation.
And in the absence of being able to time travel, I quite like this theory of one of the ways that humans came to use language.
I've actually been thinking about Robin Dunbar's theories for a different reason, because, you know, he has this very famous 150-sized, you know, social group number, which is the size of a lot of villages or small communities or small companies or small conferences. It's kind of the magic number for that kind of community. But also, there's this other number that Dunbar and colleagues have also researched, which is 4.
Hmm.
And that's the number of people that conversations tend to max out at before they start splitting into smaller conversations.
Ah, this makes a lot of sense when I think about, like, small group chat at parties and the kind of ebb and flow of when people join or leave conversations. I think that, like, that must also explain why trying to have all of your friends in one big video chat room at a, like, online party is really stressful.
Exactly. And this also shows up in fiction, it shows up in plays, it shows up in movies, that people tend to sort of max out at 4 conversation participants. And the reason for this has to do with theory of mind, which is that we find it too cognitively exhausting to keep track of the mental states of too many people.
In a specific conversation.
At once, yeah.
Yeah. So, like, I can vaguely keep track of, like, 200, 150 people in my, like, social village, but in terms of, like, the moment to moment, what do you know about the story I'm telling? 3 or 4 people is enough for me to kind of keep track of.
Right. And there's a really interesting test of this, which is that Dunbar and colleagues did an experiment where they asked people to talk about an absent third party and speculate about that absent third party's mental states.
Right.
When people were instructed to use that for their conversation, they tended to form one smaller conversational groupings, so maximum of 3. Instead of maximum of 4, when they were just asked to talk about, like, what absent third people were doing, but not what they were thinking.
I'm deeply fascinated by, like, this experiment is please come into this lab and gossip.
Right. I don't remember exactly how they set it up. But yeah, something about, you know, the maximum number of mental states that you can conceive of, you know, without getting too tired is around 5. But that means 4 people, because you're also keeping track of, like, between you and me, we have 3 mental states. Like, I'm thinking about me, I'm thinking about you, and then I'm also thinking about what you're thinking about me.
And this is why the language that we use to talk about internal mental states does particularly interesting things in grammar. So you begin to see theory of mind affect the way that we do grammar, because verbs that express internal mental states act a bit differently to other verbs.
Yeah, and like English actually has this interesting grammatical distinction between how we talk about mental state verbs versus action verbs in the present tense. So we say something like, I know, I like, I understand, I enjoy, I fear. But for action verbs, we're more likely to say something like, I am running, I am walking, I am talking.
Oh yeah, I walk implies like a I walk every day habit thing.
Right, whereas I know doesn't imply I know every day. And so there's just this sort of subtle distinction between how we talk about verbs in the present. And in the past, we don't do this. So you can say, like, I liked and I walked, and that's the same. But in the present, we have this interesting distinction that's made in English. It isn't necessarily made in other languages.
And that only really works for first person in English. It's a bit weird to say this about other people, especially the person who you're talking to.
Yeah, it's another thing that's weird about verbs about mental states, where it's sort of weird for me to be like, Lauren, you like cake. I mean,
you definitely have enough evidence to support that as a viable statement. And I think in the context of us interacting, it would be fine. But it would be very weird to say it to someone who you didn't have that knowledge for.
If I just go up to someone in a coffee shop who's eating cake and is like, you like cake, I'd be like, excuse me, but like, who invited your opinion here?
I think this is one of the things I've had to learn in teaching over the years, is it's very easy for me to be like, well, you know this because we covered it in class last week. And I just assume that everything we covered in class is completely absorbed into your knowledge state.
You mean your students don't have perfect downloads of every single, you know, audio file of your voice?
In much the same way that we don't assume that people have absorbed every single fact from Lingthusiasm when we bring them up a couple of years later.
Yeah, absolutely. And you don't retain this. And it's easy to be like, oh, I've told you once. And like, yeah, that was years ago. I don't remember everything that happened to me years ago.
It's why you end up finding, you know, a lot of question forms for second person in verb paradigms when you're trying to do this elicitation, because it's much more comfortable for people to reframe what you've said as a question.
Yeah, and I think, like, when we're used to doing this sort of decontextualized form of grammar as linguists, we're like, oh yeah, okay, I can make a verb paradigm. I like, you like, he or she likes, we like, you plural like, they like. Yeah, fine. I can just make this little paradigm for me. But the social context in which you would use each of these forms is actually really different.
Yeah, I mean, now that we've said that, I can definitely think of contexts where it would be fine to say it in English with a direct you like or you know. I think there are definitely times where it would be safe to say it to a child that you are very close to. Like, I know you like toast. We ate toast for breakfast yesterday. And lo and behold, they like toast. They just need to be reminded of that.
But even there, you were like, I know you like toast, which is sort of a, you know, not quite as committed to the statement as you like toast.
Yeah.
Or if you want to say to a dog or something like, you want your dinner? Yes, I know you want your dinner. You're going to have your dinner. Yeah, here we go. You know, but it's, I think to say to an adult, I mean, maybe if I walk in on you in your office and I'm like, oh, you're busy, I'll come back later. Or like, oh, you're reading, you're on the phone, I'll come back later. You know, there are certainly contexts in which you could do it, but you have to do a lot more contextual setup.
I love how much setup you had to do to get to that as a valid way of using an internal state verb directly at someone.
Yeah, whereas if I say, yeah, I know, I like cake, this doesn't require any setup. This is just the unmarked thing to do.
And this is why we separate out these verbs about internal mental states, or psych verbs, as they're sometimes called, and look at them separately to other verbs in English, because talking about someone else's mental state changes the way that we can use them in grammar.
And some psych verbs come in pairs. So you can say, like, I like cake, or cake pleases me. You know, or I fear dogs, dogs frighten me. And in both cases, you're sort of having the same relationship between the two entities, but the verb like flips them, which you don't always see with like actions. Sometimes you see it with actions like I buy this from you, you sell it to me. But it seems to be one of the things that happens with internal mental state verbs.
And they also tend to have more variation across languages and across cultures as to how you can use them.
Yeah, there's a really interesting and subtle example of this in English and Spanish, where in English, it's less common to say something like you understand, you know, with the meaning of I infer you understand based on the evidence of you seeming to understand. Whereas in Spanish, you know, have a verb that seems like it should correspond to English understand, but it is reasonable to use that verb to mean I infer you understand because you're asking really good questions, or I infer you understand because you are making noises of comprehension and you're nodding and so on. Mm. And it's reasonable to say of someone you understand with the meaning like, it seems to me that you understand, or I observe you to be understanding.
That is a subtle but important meaning distinction, I feel.
And I heard this anecdote from a linguist who, I don't remember which linguist anymore, who said that they'd told this to somebody, you know, an English speaker and Spanish speaker who were in a marriage together, and they both spoke each other's languages, but they didn't have an understanding that this was actually a pragmatic difference between them. Ah. And so sometimes they would get in fights by like, what do you mean you say I understand? You don't know that what's going on in my internal mental state. You're just assuming what I know, which was actually a systematic pragmatic difference in how the languages use those particular mental state verbs rather than like a case of just not understanding between the partners.
That is amazing. The thing I find really interesting about that anecdote is that the distinction between the two forms of understand was really implicit between the two languages.
Right.
And I'm really interested in those grammatical features where knowledge state becomes very overt. And that's essentially what motivated me to study how we grammatically track source of information, which is the area of evidentiality. And we had a whole episode on that I will not assume you've listened to, and I will not assume you remember anything from, but essentially evidentiality is used to keep track of, depending on the language, whether you know something because you saw it or because someone else told you about it, or maybe you're not entirely certain about it. And this is marked as a feature of the grammar rather than just being implicit or optional.
So in English, you have the option of saying something like, it's raining, I can see that it's raining, I can guess that it's raining because I can hear the raindrops, or because someone's walked in and their, you know, shoulders and umbrella are all soaking wet. Mm-hmm. And you can say all of those things to indicate the source of your knowledge, but you don't have to. You could just say it's raining and let someone else figure out how you came to know that information.
Exactly. Whereas if we look at a language like Yolmo in Nepal that I've worked with, you can actually see someone's knowledge state changing throughout the story that they're telling, because maybe they start with talking about something in a way where they're, you know, they're not certain if this cake is going to be delicious. And then they talk about how someone told them it's going to be delicious. And then finally, they have direct sensory evidence of how delicious the cake is. So you see how their knowledge about the cake being delicious is really clearly marked by the grammatical choices that they have to make throughout the story. So it means that I can keep track of someone else's source of evidence in a way that's more direct than in English. And it means that people are more attentive to mine as well.
So if you want to say something like, I infer that you understand, you would be doing that with the evidential marker, or you told me that you understood this yesterday, so why don't you understand it today? Then you'd have a lot of ways of marking the differences between those internal mental states.
Yes, and those internal state experiences of if someone's unwell or if someone's hungry, I have to mark them differently if I don't have any direct visual evidence. If you're unwell and you're, you know, shaking and feverish, I can say that I can see you're unwell, but if you're unwell in a way that I can't see, I have to use other grammatical ways of marking it. And so how you interact with other people's internal states varies because sometimes you don't have access to a direct source of evidence for it.
I feel like I'm just picturing those like little cartoons that you get in language learning textbooks where they have these various stereotype representations of common illnesses that don't have obvious physical things. So like, you know, I have a headache will be like a person like holding their head in great distress or with like a hot water bottle on their head. And you're like, I don't put a hot water bottle on my head when I have a headache, you know, or like somebody who has a thermometer sticking out of your mouth or something to indicate these sort of things that aren't really easily visually represented.
And it's because figuring out someone else's internal state is actually a really complicated cognitive task that we do, and we fall back on these tropes to help us navigate that.
And I guess same for teaching other types of mental state verbs, you know or understand or like or something. Mm-hmm. Like, you have these maybe very stereotyped or symbolic representations. If you have someone with a heart or something, maybe they're liking it or loving it. But, like, it's difficult to do a picture of, like, I know, I understand. Not everything is easily visualizable.
And you talked earlier about how it was kind of a revelation for you at some point that maybe we can't really know what's happening in other people's minds. And there is a lot of cultural variation as to how much people are willing to feel like they're able to intuit the internal states of other people. So much so that there's a whole area of anthropology that looks at this idea of cultures where it's really prevalent to assume that you can't know someone else's internal state. And that's the kind of starting point for building social interactions.
So this is this sort of inverse of the Spanish thing where it's like, yeah, I can infer your mental state. This is like, nobody can really know what anyone else is thinking at all.
Yeah, it's kind of a cultural assumption and starting point for building conversations and interactions that I'm going to assume that I can't know what your internal state is. I can only make reference to it by very overtly flagging that I don't know that. So I might talk about your actions rather than my assumptions about the thoughts behind those actions.
Okay, so what does it look like in practice if someone's operating under the assumption that you can never really understand what's going on in someone else's mind?
A lot of the anthropologists who work in this area tend to look at the domain of gossip. And I like to think of it in terms of, it just means that you're unlikely to have gossip that goes along the lines of, what were they even thinking?
Oh.
Instead, your gossip is more about the concrete actions of people rather than rationalizing their mental state while they were doing those things.
Okay, so not like this person had good intentions, but this thing didn't work, or this person, you know, never cares about other people's feelings, and so therefore, but it's more like, oh, this person, you know, did this thing, ate my cake.
Yeah, I mean, assuming someone has good intentions is something that presumes that you can know what's inside someone else's mind.
So it's like, this person ate my cake, I don't care why they did it, but that's what happened.
Yeah, that tends to be more of the focus that gets talked about, or that people might come upon using strategies like grammatical evidentiality as a, like, you can't know what's in my mind, so let me tell you that I know that it's raining because someone said or because I saw it. Like, let me do that work for you of telling you my state of knowledge rather than you trying to guess something that you can't guess.
So it's not necessarily a thing of, you know, we're not talking about mental states, but the person is the ultimate authority on their own mental state.
Yeah, I think this area of opacity of mind kind of is looking at commonalities between what are actually very different ways of approaching understanding people's internal states, because perhaps culturally we've just gone with the assumption that everyone thinks about social interaction the way we do, and that maybe there's a lot of variation there.
Lauren, are you saying we have bad theory of mind about theory of mind?
Potentially. But I think learning about theory of mind as a kind of bedrock and then opacity of mind as the way people approach this bedrock has made me more appreciative of keeping track of what people might know or not making assumptions about what people bring to any particular interaction. And I really appreciate knowing about theory of mind for that reason.
Yeah. And I think, like, you know, practicing figuring out, okay, what are some possible mental states here? What might be going on? And this is one of the things that I really like about fiction, especially reading books, is you do get to be sort of behind someone else's eyes and thinking about what they're doing and why they're doing it, even if their reasons for doing something are really different from what I would think. And, you know, I find sort of filmed stuff, unless there's a lot of voiceover, I love voiceover, because you get in someone's mind. I know people, not everyone's a fan of voiceover, but I love it because it gives you that internal mental state. I don't just want to look at someone's face and think, oh, this is what they're thinking. I want to be like behind their eyes and thinking, oh, they actually think this is a good idea. Okay, well, I'm along for this ride now.
Yeah, I think fiction is a really great philosophical experiment. And it's one of the reasons I really find sci-fi to be interesting, is because it can push the limits of what another mind is or what another mental state is to be thinking in. One thing we didn't get to in the bonus episode about Arkady Martin's memory called Empire is that there are people who have the capacity to take on the entire previous knowledge state of someone else. And I just am like, what would an evidential marking system be like for a person who has multiple consciousnesses worth of evidence for a statement?
Like, I know this because my original consciousness knew this, or I know this because the consciousness that I got added to mine later in life knows this. Oh, man.
Yeah, there are just so many layers of potential knowledge state there. And that's the kind of sci-fi that lets me bring my linguist brain to problems of consciousness.
Yeah, I've been thinking about this from a practical level as well recently, which is sort of like, what's the point of having a conference compared to just reading some blog posts or something about the same topic? And I think it's about that conferences create a state of shared knowledge among their participants. You know that everyone else was also at the same talks or in the same environment or is interested in the same topic. And so it gives you springboards for having conversations about topics of mutual interest.
Mm-hmm.
Rather than just like, I've acquired this information. It's I've acquired this information in a social context where I've also acquired a bunch of people to talk with about it.
I've never quite thought of conferences in that way, but that is a very wholesome linguist brain way to approach it.
Well, it's sort of partly why digital conferences can be unsatisfying, because if you don't know who else is in the audience and you don't have any way of spending time with them, then you don't get to have that shared mental state with the fellow conference participants. You're just receiving the knowledge in a way that you could do without the conference structure at all.
And I think that speaks to the way that approaching theory of mind allows you to just be more generous in the way you conceptualize other people's intentions or their motivations or their actions, which is one thing I really appreciate about it.
And I also think that there's, I mean, this is definitely not in the canon of theory of mind, but it's sort of part of this thinking and reasoning about other people's mental states. It's also sort of what the mental state is that you impose on someone else by reacting to something.
Okay.
So
I'm now very conscious about whatever I say in response to this anecdote.
I'm sorry. So an example of this is the XKCD comic Lucky 10,000, which reads, I try not to make fun of people for admitting they don't know things, because for each thing everyone knows by the time they're adults, every day there are on average 10,000 people in the US hearing about it for the first time, and there's some calculations.
Mm-hmm.
If I make fun of people, I train them to not tell me when they have these moments and I miss out on the fun. And then the little comic strip is the two people. One says, Diet Coke and Mentos thing, what's that? And the other one says, oh man, come on, we're going to the grocery store. Why? You're one of today's Lucky 10,000. And some of my friend groups have adopted Lucky 10,000 when someone mentions like, oh, what is this book or what is this thing? Rather than say, oh, you haven't heard of that? What?
I can actually tell you exactly how Gretchen says it, because Gretchen said to me when we were preparing for this, oh, you haven't heard of the Lucky 10,000? Oh my gosh, do I have the link for you?
Exactly.
And it was so nice to not feel embarrassed to not know every comic in a canonical webcomic series and to be introduced to this very excellent one.
And it makes the conversation happen in a much more positive way, because then, you know, like, nobody's read all the books, nobody's done all of the things. You can have the conversation of, oh, well, what did you like about it? Or what is interesting about it? Without the sort of shaming version of the conversation of, why haven't you done this? Or why, what's wrong with you that you don't know this thing already? I think there's similar things that happens when you create things as well. Like, I wrote a book or on this podcast, and sometimes we'll say something there or give some, you know, here's a set of examples or something. And sometimes people will reply, oh, I listened to your thing. I liked your thing. And here's this other example for you. Like, here's another thing that you might like. And that frame is a really positive way of having that conversation and is something that I can then share with other people. Say, oh, here's this other thing that people might be interested in. I can retweet it. Or here's something else going on.
I always feel bad when people phrase it as though we have deliberately omitted something for nefarious reasons, when it's often just that, well, we have a finite amount of time and there are many languages.
And also, we don't know everything. And sometimes someone tells us about a new example.
Sometimes we get to be one of the lucky 10,000 for a topic in linguistics, and it makes us very happy.
Yeah. And the thing is like, the intentions are generally really good. People are excited to share things. They're excited to talk about things. And it's just this sort of like common way of responding to things that doesn't end up leading into the conversation that you want to have. And that with a slight tweak could totally do that, like the Lucky 10,000 thing.
I also think about this modeling other people's mental states and knowledge. I think one of the like peak activities for that is creating a forwardable email. So for those of us who spend a lot of time on email, occasionally someone will say, cool, I'm glad we've agreed to do this thing. Can you put the details in a forwardable email so I can send it to the rest of the group?
Right. Or can you introduce me to this person? You know, here's why I think they'd be interested to talk about it. And they'll say, okay, I'll write a forwardable email and I can send it to them. And then they can decide if they want to talk to you or something like that.
And so me and this other person know that this email exchange has happened. I now need to write a single, useful, context-filled email that that person can forward on to the group that they want to do the thing with or someone that I am hoping to be introduced to. And it requires me to think about what I know, what the person who asked me to do this email knows, and what this third person who hasn't been part of any of the prior conversation but needs all of the relevant context needs to know. And I just think that the mental state modeling involved and the mentalizing what this person who hasn't been part of the conversation needs is like Dunbar's mental representation stuff as like multidimensional chess.
Yeah, because you end up saying, like, to the person you're actually emailing, you're telling them all of this information they already know. And that's why you can sometimes specify to someone like, oh yeah, please send me an email that I can forward to this person. And so if I'm receiving a forwardable email, I know that you're repeating information that I know, and it's not patronizing in this context because you know that I'm going to forward it to this third person who doesn't know these things. And so therefore, that's why you're repeating this information that I already knew. You know, there's so many levels of understanding what other people are going to potentially think in there.
And so this is why, before we even get to thinking about language, we have to think about the cognitive processes that allow us to know where the marble is, to know if someone thinks cake is delicious, or to be able to put everything into an email.
For more Lingthusiasm and links to all the things mentioned in this episode, go to lingthusiasm.com. You can listen to us on Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, SoundCloud, YouTube, or wherever else you get your podcasts. And you can follow at Lingthusiasm on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and Tumblr. You can get IPA scarves, what the fricative mugs, and other Lingthusiasm merch at lingthusiasm.com/merch. I can be found as at Gretchen A. McSee on Twitter. My blog is allthingslinguistic.com, and my book about internet language is called Because Internet.
I tweet and blog as Superlinguo. Have you listened to all the Lingthusiasm episodes and you wish there were more? You can get access to 54 bonus episodes to listen to right now at patreon.com/lingthusiasm or follow the links from our website. Patrons also get access to our Discord chat room to talk with other linguistics fans and other rewards, as well as helping keep the show ad-free. Recent bonus topics include the linguistics of Pokemon, backchanneling, and translation in fiction. Can't afford to pledge? That's okay too. We also really appreciate it if you can recommend Lingthusiasm to anyone who needs a little more linguistics in their lives.
Lingthusiasm is created and produced by Gretchen McCulloch and Lauren Gawne. Our senior producer is Claire Gawne, our editorial producer is Sarah Dapirala, and our production manager is Liz McCullough, and our music is Ancient City by The Triangles.
Stay Lingthusiastic.